Hey everybody out there, my name is Dragnix, and it's that time of year again. The carolers are singing, the chestnuts are roasting, and YouTubers are publishing top 10 lists like they've all become Watch Mojo channels. And I'm no exception to that rule. However, I don't like starting off with your typical top 10 lists. Everyone can talk about their game of the year or the worst disasters of 2016, but I'd rather put focus on games that could use a little bit of a boost. So this list looks at games that I believe didn't get the sales that they deserve, mostly due to their superior quality compared to the rest of the games I played this year. Now there's a couple of requirements for this list. I had to play and review the game. Okay, simple enough. In addition, the game could not have sold more than 50,000 copies based on Steam Spy data. 50,000 copies isn't all that much when you think about it, especially when some of these games really brought something new to the table. In addition, if I think the game was properly covered by larger sites, then it probably didn't make this list as well. With the Steam Winter Sale in full swing, here are the games that I think were the hidden gems of this year. And if the short blurbs for the game don't do enough to convince you, there will be appropriate links to all reviews in each section of this list. Consider this my Christmas gift to you all. These are the top 10 overlooked games of 2016. Number 10, Duskers. Don't let the wire visuals and the presence of a command line fool you. Duskers uses its simple presentation to capture the true essence of the roguelike experience, punishing difficulty while rewarding smart and strategic gameplay. The game's concept is simple. Use a set of drones to explore the dark, abandoned ships filled with foreign bacteria, deadly robots, and just general despair. But unlike its action-oriented brothers such as Binding of Isaac and Enter the Gungeon, Duskers is all about slow and methodical progress, as you use all your skills to probe rooms for information and not walk into a world of trouble. Strategy is the name of the game here, as you send a drone cloaked in the shadows of invisibility to find a threat in the next room. From there, you have options of how to deal with it, like you could open a series of doors to lure it into a specific room, and then jettison it out the airlock to continue on. The game is at its best when the panic sets in as a mission starts to go astray due to a variable you didn't account for. You do everything to try to minimize your damage and save your drones, attempting to run to live to fight another day. However, it still has the slow burn effect on gameplay as well. You realize that your fuel and scrap start to dwindle away little by little, forcing you to take more risks to keep this run going. It's a game for patient players, that's for sure, but if you're a strategy lover at heart, then Duskers will be a game that you'll keep coming back to now and again. Number 9, Neon Chrome. Neon Chrome is the case where a game just came out at the wrong time. Enter the Gungeon had come out a couple of weeks prior, and considering the polish on a game like that, well, it's easy to see where Neon Chrome would get overlooked in the top-down roguelike genre. But here's the thing, in a genre that seems to be moving towards more dodging and blocking mechanics over strict gunplay, Neon Chrome feels like a breath of fresh air. It solely relies on WASD movement and shooting your enemies until they die, or blowing a hole in the wall so that you can chuck grenades at them, or finding stronger weapons via the environment so you can shoot things better. Do you see a pattern here, that this game is all about the combat and gunplay? It's a game that makes you want to keep on fighting, as having enemies center in on your position with reinforcements can be pulse-pounding, because they actually make a difference as they rush you. It also helps that the game's progression system makes you want to build up your stats to get further and further up the tower, unlocking new abilities as well as new character types to open up the action strategy even more. Sure, it's visually unimpressive, and the story could use a little bit more color in the end, but when it comes to hours of top-down shooting to enjoy with a one-more-run mentality, Neon Chrome shines brightly. Number 8, The Bug Butcher. Sometimes a game doesn't need a huge feature set or shiny toys to be worthy of a purchase. Sometimes it just takes a simple, tried and true concept, and that's shooting bugs with a big ass gun. Yes, the Bug Butcher is of the Pang genre, aka you only move from left to right and shoot upward. That may sound unexciting to you, but sometimes from a simple cocoon of gameplay comes a beautiful butterfly of arcade goodness. In a strong neon aesthetic, the Bug Butcher has you rely on your quick reflexes to gun down waves upon waves of insects. It's one of the best in the genre that I've played, letting newbies survive by the skin of their teeth, while allowing skilled players to rack up huge combo scores while dropping enemy after enemy. It's the kind of game that's mechanically simple on the surface, but little things like how enemies move after you hit them end up really playing a huge part into your strategy. With good enemy variety and some power-ups in the arcade-type mode that are fun to use, it's a great game to play if you've got 5 to 10 minutes to spare. And then you realize it's 2 hours later and curse yourself for spending so long playing it. It's addictive, and while it could use a tiny more content for the long haul, at the price you can get it at, it's definitely a steal. Number 7. DarkMaus. One of the things that always seems to irk me when looking at games to review is when I see a game use another established franchise in its game description, or even its title. Rarely does the game live up to what it's trying to compare itself to. There are exceptions to this rule, of course, and DarkMaus definitely is the exception to that rule. What impressed me about DarkMaus is the fact that a single developer created one of the best spatial combat systems I've seen in an indie game. Pretty much ever. From a technical standpoint, the amount of precision that this engine shows is astounding. The angle in which a shield protects you is the actual length of the shield. There's no invisible barriers of extra damage protection here. And that drives a simple yet engulfing combat system that will remind you of a Dark Souls game almost immediately. While the simple color presentation and dark atmosphere does do wonders for the game, it's all about this game's combat. Picking the right weapon to gain an advantage on an enemy is crucial, and finding that one spot to break through their defenses was always satisfying. You had to change up your tactics based on your enemies, and in particular, your environment, as using tight corridors or long hallways to funnel enemies was always a smart thing to do. Look, it's almost a meme at this point when a game is compared to Dark Souls. I get that. And knowing that fully well, I can confidently say that DarkMaus is like Dark Souls. And unlike other cases, this is not a stretch. This is a good comparison. Number 6. Death Road to Canada. While the Walking Dead TV series needs to be put out of its misery, I can't say the same thing for this mix-up of an action roguelike with Oregon Trail. See, Death Road to Canada focuses on one basic concept in order to succeed. Fun. Remember that? Fun? You know the enjoyment you get out of playing a game and just having a good time without psychoanalyzing every single element of the game on whether it's racist, sexist, or good for society? Sure, a game can discuss these things, but Death Road to Canada would rather have you beat the living hell out of a zombie with a mop while Link desperately runs around for his life. Its combat is simple but effective, having you manage space like bullets in a world overrun by walkers. You manage your breakable equipment and various skills of your teammates to scavenge for gas, more equipment, and other survivors as you make your way to the safety of the Great White North. While there is a repetition element that comes into play here over time, it never honestly feels boring, as the chaos of enraged zombies coming for your tasty, tasty flesh never ceases to cause you panic and fun in the process. But like most good depictions of zombies within modern-day media, the zombies and the violence are only the backdrop for the tales of these survivors stuck in this infested world. Whether you choose to take a hill at 100 miles per hour in order to avoid a blockade by renegade saviors, or convincing Octodad to join your immigration to Hockey's hometown, the event system is the highlight of the game, weaving a tale of madness while throwing in some good humor along the way. Sure, you may die because of some bad luck in these segments, but it's one of those games that will give you stories to tell around the water cooler. For example, depicting Sean and Ed's travels, how they met aliens, ran into Santa beating a zombie with a 2x4, and eventually dragged their almost lifeless corpses to the final fortress of solitude. If that sounds like your cup of tea, I'd go grab it on Steam and put your friends to the game via the customization option. because it's always better when you're connected to the chaos. At the halfway point of this video, I did want to indicate some honorable mentions. Part of the reason I do these lists at this time of year is so that people pick up some games that they may not have given a chance before. Those hidden gems that really bring the best that gaming has to offer, in my opinion. Rabi-Ribi is a Metroidvania game with bunny girls and a general anime-like aesthetic. While it failed to make this list due to my 50,000 sold copy requirement, it's still an overlooked game as people see the bunny girls and cutesy art style and don't think it's gonna give them a challenge. Well, rest assured, Rabi-Ribi's good enemy layout and integration of bullet hell mechanics into boss fights makes for a unique experience, and one that can really adjust depending on the difficulty level that you choose. Good exploration and artwork rounds out a fluffy experience that I have you hopping around like no other. It's been a while since we've had a deep Sim Tower-like experience, but Project Highrise built the foundation of its spiritual successor. With Lazy Game Reviews and other big YouTubers covering it, it did break the 50,000 copies requirement here, but don't overlook this simulation game with surprising depth. There's some relaxing and satisfying elements about customizing your tower, going OCD as you try to perfectly put down apartments and businesses in a symmetrical-like fashion. With mod elements, it's gaining a little bit more variety for the long run. And well, if you liked Sim Tower, you are going to like Project Highrise. While Owlboy technically is under the 50,000 copies limit, it did that in less than a month, and was covered by the big sites like IGN and GameSpot, hence why it's not on the main list. Nevertheless, Owlboy is a fantastic presentation of a new style platformer that focuses on aerial action. While it could be wiser in some of the variety elements of the gameplay here, the core of its masterful controls and its touching story creates a game that you'll want to give a hoot about. You'll get lost in these wonderful visuals and a very, very good soundtrack. It's not for those who want a pure gameplay experience, in my opinion, but if you like a solid package overall, Owlboy delivers in spades. Number 5. Stories, The Path of Destinies. Do you remember as a child those old choose-your-own-adventure books, where you'd read a bit and then you'd get a choice and skip to the appropriate page depending on your choice? And that there were 20 or so paths that you'd go through, and if you were like me, you'd read every one. That story's The Path of Destinies in a nutshell, although it's sandwiched in between some solid gameplay and a beautiful set of environments. With a narrator that does a great job of putting a unique spin on the game's events, you feel like you're being read an old fairy tale, but with a modern spin on it to make it part of the cool kids crowd. It's sly like a fox in that delivery, as you learn little by little going through each route, but if you're paying attention, you can see the story that's going to unfold. It's wrapped up in a wonderful presentation, as the voice acting is fantastic, and the characters' designs may seem simple, but really do well to emphasize the traits of the characters. Its gameplay is good in the combat department, with some solid controls and a simple yet effective blocking system. Sadly, however, it can turn into a button masher rather quickly. It's still enjoyable, but you're not gonna get high-level gameplay from this game. This game is great for those who love sprawling stories, and I find it to be fantastic for kids. If you're looking for a last-minute holiday selection for a niece or nephew, this game is perfect for them, in my opinion. It's family-friendly, and yet still has some jokes that the adults will enjoy too. Number 4. Enigma. Never has a game's title been so appropriate. Enigma is a game that is a hard one to sell you on without giving away its plot. That coupled with the fact that it's a visual novel makes it hard to convince someone to pick it up. But even among critics, including myself, the rating for the game has been all over the place. Some say it's fantastic, some say it's crap. It truly is a mystery on whether the average person would love this game or not. However, I firmly fall into the love side of the spectrum for this game. It's a game that centers around the last days of a man named Chester, who's got a terminal disease. His boat ends up crashing on a mysterious island, and he's rescued by the inhabitants of said island. What develops from there is a story that centers around Chester and the relationships he makes with these certain key islanders. It's about how one man with limited time left ends up connecting so strongly with random strangers in a variety of different ways through the different branches of the plot. The story ends up having elements of fantasy, mystery, and even horror. However, what it did best was touch me at my very soul, while still discussing issues surrounding death and the mysteries of the world. It balances emotions with reality, not purposefully pulling on your heartstrings, but recognizing that, hey, life is not fair at times, and shit is going to happen. It's a touching story, one that made me cry on several occasions, and has a moment or two that knocked me out of my seat. It's all done with some beautiful artwork, which sets the stage for a set of characters that I will remember for years to come. The only reason that it's not higher on this list is the fact that it seems to be very hit and miss for people, and I recognize that not everyone will appreciate the way that the story is told here. However, it should say something that regardless of those concerns, that it's this high on the list, because my experience with this game is one that I hope is replicated. Number 3, Ghost 1.0. One of the biggest disappointments I've had as a gamer over the last several years is the lack of good Metroidvania games. With Samus sitting on the sideline and Konami taking Castlevania and putting it 6 feet into the ground, I've had to look to the indie scene to get my fix. Thankfully, Ghost 1.0 not only filled that niche rather nicely, but it did it while improving an element that usually gets overlooked in the genre, the story. The gameplay is the star here, as the variety in firefights and different weapons that you can pick up lead to some chaotic yet epic encounters. The Phantom of Samus is strong here, as choosing the right weapon to take care of enemies can be key, and you'll have to do it while running around for your life, as the game doesn't hesitate to haunt you with everything else in the area, basically throwing everything but the kitchen sink at you. It's topped off by some really fun boss fights for the most part, which feel like epic encounters that you'll barely scrape by on at times. You'll have fun exploring the environment and taking a look at the little touches that the game has made, like the reflection of your main character in a window. This is a game that may not look fancy in its presentation, but it relies on the little things to wow you in its art direction and music selection. It's set in the backdrop of an actually interesting story that will make you want to finish it completely to see what happens to these crew of freedom fighters. It's a game that celebrates the history of gaming and sci-fi with its references, and it's a game that will put a goofy grin on your face as you play through it thanks to its humor. If you were an NES or SNES kid, it's pretty much a must-have game. Number 2, Furi. I did not expect to see this game on this list, mostly because I expected it to sell a lot more. It's probably its higher price point, but you'd think that a game about dueling as samurais would make people flock to it like a weeaboo to an anime convention. It's a boss rush type game, but with a bit of meat to it, as each of the game's bosses bring a unique fight to the table and make you feel like you're in an old western of sorts, staring each other down in the streets of a deserted town. In a methodical combat system about positioning, blocking, and pattern recognition, you'll run into enemies that will get close and personal with you, then follow that up with a series of bullet hell sections. Each wave of each of the boss fights brings something new that you'll have to deal with, and really puts your timing abilities to the test. Its biggest strength is the reliance on the KISS principle, aka, keep it simple, stupid. No huge combos or huge set of skills, just a couple of basic abilities and your own wits to rely on. And yet, it makes for some of the best combat I experienced this year. But beyond its gameplay is a really unique art style and wonderful character designs, done by the same person who did the designs on Afro Samurai. It's a visual paradise here of neon colors, all complemented by some great music to get your adrenaline pumping. The story does have some good twists and turns as well, but it's definitely not the focus of this game at all. If you want strategic action, then Furi is everything that you'd want and more, and you should pick it up as soon as you can. Number 1. Valhalla Cyberpunk Bartender Action. I want to make this clear. It's a damn shame that this game hasn't sold 100,000 copies. Hell, a million copies. And here's a bit of a spoiler. Not only is it in my top 10 games of the year, it's in the top 3. Hell, it's a strong contender for my game of the year. It's still fighting two other games for that honor, but it's clear that it's by far the game that has been the most overlooked during this year. And that may surprise you if you read the description of the game. Valhalla Cyberpunk Bartender Action is a boozem-up about waifus, technology, and post-dystopia life. But to be upfront, this game is basically a visual novel. Sure, your choices of progression are based on pouring specific drinks to push a client into spilling their worries or their secrets to our protagonist Jill. And that may sound boring to you if you're more of a gameplay connoisseur. But here's the thing. Valhalla is one of the most brilliantly written experiences I've had with video games. Ever. Yes, when I think of brilliantly written games, games like Danganronpa 2, games like Final Fantasy VI, games like The World Ends With You, Valhalla earns a spot alongside them. How? How can a small indie game like this stand with some of the giants in the industry? The answer to that is quite simple. Heart. What this game does right is several fold. First, it introduces a wide variety of interesting characters that you want to know more about. A hacker with family problems and a pressure on her to get married. An android-like prostitute that has a heart of gold. A talking Shiba dog with sunglasses and a mysterious past. Every character in this game, human or not, has enormous depth to them emotionally, having you connect with them almost immediately. Then the game tells those characters' various stories in a therapeutic-like environment. The presentation of the story is a lot different than most of the modern-day tales, mostly because it feels very, very personal. In a lot of games, you feel like you're on the sideline, watching two characters talk back and forth, but maybe not invested as much as you should be. Valhalla, on the other hand, immersed me like no other game did. Despite the fact that you're playing as Jill and she has her own lines, it feels like the characters are talking to you. Why it's so good is how inclusive it is. And I'm not talking about the type of inclusive where you're with us or you're against us type of mentalities I see when that word is brought up. I'm talking about plot lines that bring up serious issues. Issues that some other games may be unwilling to talk about due to their stigma. And presents both sides of the issue for you to think about. It's clear that the writers here wanted you to think about the complexity of these issues, but let you decide what side you'd want to take. It takes a really talented set of writers to do this over the length of a game, and behold, Valhalla delivered that in spades. Look, I could go on all day about how much this game stood out to me this year. Hell, go check my Twitter feed over the last 6 months. Note how often I bring it up for game recommendations to random people. It's a game that has stuck with me till this day. And while yes, it may not be an action platformer or an FPS, it is a game that I believe that even the biggest critics of writing in video games will appreciate how well Valhalla told its story. I don't say this often. I'm the person who matches video games to you. I recognize that most people have their preferences, and to tell everyone to play Doom, for example, would be silly. But in Valhalla's case, I'm willing to make an exception. Pick up this game. You'll be glad you did. Anyway, that's it for this list, and I want to wish everyone out there a Merry Christmas and a Happy Holidays. I hope you get what you want, and play a lot of video games in the meanwhile. As to what's coming up on the channel, I do have a Shantae Half Genie Hero review and a Last Guardian review that I'm working on top of the fact that I'm working on that X-Blades video that will be coming out on January 10th. I will try to do a Top 10 Games of the Year video, but honestly, I don't know how I'm gonna fit that in considering everything else going on. Anyway, I will see you guys all later, and as always, keep on gaming.